because of that memory, I ended up in joy. It really opened up. We went out and we drank, two highballs, or whatever you call them. And then we went bar hopping. And had a good time until the bars closed. All three of us were pretty lit up by the time we got back here. And we put a fire in the fireplace in Barbara's room and sat up there bullshitting all morning long. We had some grass, and I had a little cocaine, and then I had to come back down here, and by that time Linda was up and active and ready to go, so I didn't get any rest that morning. I did grab a couple hours late in the afternoon, just flopped out. I put a pillow on the floor and zonked, and then that carried over to yesterday, and I was running around yesterday. I have a few things that I literally have to attend to each day, and that's about all. And then last night, somehow or another, I couldn't settle down. You know, you get so wound up that your head is just spinning and you've got all these thoughts going on in your mind, and that's exactly the condition I was in last night. And although, then I kept getting phone calls.
What kind of thoughts?
Well, about daily activity, how much I hate myself, loathing, self-loathing, and how screwed up everything is, and how screwed up I am.
The FBI caught Huncke and gave him some marijuana, said, plant this in Ginsberg's house, and we won't bother you anymore. Huncke called up Allen and told what the FBI said. I was there. Allen immediately called up Robert Kennedy, because Robert Kennedy had gotten in touch with Allen earlier on getting the vote, let's see, with the people that Allen knew. And Allen knew a lot of people, and he knew he was an influence in New York. So Allen calls up Robert Kennedy and says, look, get the FBI off my back. They got this guy, Herbert Huncke. They want to lay pot on him and plant it in my house so I get busted. And bam, never again did it happen to Allen. Now that's a fact of life.
It could have been any time from, we'll say, roughly 47 or 45, might be that far back, to about 54.
Yeah, I went there 17 years old. At 17, I left at 19. I only saw you. I don't care about the age of people. If I could put my parents on, so I'd put you. See, I know, sister, it's good. But these fuckers are heavyweight, too.
Herbert Huncke is a seminal figure among the Beats. He's probably the first Beat. There's some controversy over who used the word first in print, but there's no controversy about the fact that the expression comes from Herbert. I'm beat. It's beat. Beat dope, whatever. He's also the first hipster, undoubtedly, that they ever met. And he's the first to be on the road way before Kerouac. As a young man, Herbert got off to a fast start. As a teenager, in fact, he met the fastest crowd in town, got involved in, we can call it love, sex, drugs, and the road very, very early.
I had run away when I was 12, came back for a short while, and more or less stayed in Chicago until about 16, going on 17. Meanwhile, I had acquired a habit on drugs, and I went looking for them, really, mostly searching for a sense of freedom, I guess, a sense of happiness someplace, trying to get away from the, I don't know, the restrictions and discipline of family life.
a disturbed family, I might add, in that everyone was very emotional and there was a lot of, you know, chaos, not physical chaos, although occasionally something like that would take place, but mostly, you know, inwardly, to get at peace with myself, to escape from being accused of being stupid and a nonconformist, not being willing to knuckle down to what is generally considered the proper behavior for a young boy.
In fact, I think Chicago put the Beats on the map. When we gave a poetry reading there in 1958, it was in every newspaper.
That was the big one.
That was the big one. It was Chicago that did it. They loved us.
It was in Time Magazine.
Everything. Time Magazine, all the papers there and all that. We were on the biggest famous shows there.
That was a real breakthrough.
That was a breakthrough. And Ginsberg and I hit it off without even planning. What we did was he read his Howl poem, which is heavyweight series, and I read my Manage poem, which is heavyweight series, funny. So, and we both put each other down. Me and Ginsberg yelled at each other that they couldn't touch us. For instance, one of the people in the audience said, Mr. Ginsberg, why is there so much homosexuality in your poetry? And I said, because I'm queer, madam. Yuck, 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 yuck. I mean, there was no way they could touch us. No way.
I didn't see any predominant homosexual proclivities in Kerouac. Not to the same extent, of course, that I saw them in Ginsberg or felt them in Burroughs. See, for a long time, Burroughs never really tipped his mitt verbally. By tipping his mitt, I mean saying anything of a homosexual, you know, implication. Although, you know, by the time I'd known him, it was a short while, he let his hair down a little bit and I began to see other things.
There are guys that don't think of anything but the moment. That's what's incredible. We've never heard Herbert worry about next month's rent or tomorrow's meal or Gregory either. If they're full right now, they're happy. They're fantastic guys. What a totally different ethic, you know. Everyone else is frightened to death. I'm frightened to death. Oh my God, the rent's coming up. What am I gonna do? You know, how am I gonna do it? I envy them in a way that somehow they broke away from all the traditional moorings.
To walk the whole city. I walked from one end to the other. All hours of the day, all hours of the night. I started to do that when I was a child. I never wanted to stay around the home front. I preferred to get out and see what was going on. And I got along beautifully with all kinds of people, strange people, straight people, people, deviants of all kinds. I was very fortunate in that I didn't run across any killers, I guess, because I could have easily been killed. I could have been abused pretty badly if I, you know, hadn't been lucky in the people that I met. But somehow or another, I got along with all kinds. I could sense a certain way of doing with these people so that I tried to talk to them as much as they talked to me or draw attention to whatever it was that they were hung up on, we'll say, whatever it was that they wanted to do with me.
Herbert brought them a new language, a special language of the streets, an argot of initiates, a language that excluded squares, that could be understood only by people who used it. It came from blacks, prison talk, the association of people hiding out from the law, fugitives, underground types, whatever. But it was fresh, perceptive, and exciting to those people. It'd be exciting to anybody. He also brought an attitude. Herbert always had an attitude. He did what he wanted to do, and he did what he had to do.
A cat doesn't worry about whether he has black fur or red fur. gets along with other cats, and if he doesn't, he scraps with them a little bit and goes on about his business.
With Gregory also, he really saw that the poetry is inseparable from the life. And New York Quarterly, which is a magazine of poetry, had an editorial not so long ago about people who wanted to live a certain type of life, and yet if you live that kind of life, which is to say getting grants, having cushy academic jobs, and then you're going to write like a lion, no way. Where Gregory believes that the poet and his life are inseparable. And Huncke's life and his writing have been inseparable. Neither are college professors, neither have cushy jobs, neither have honorariums or grants or whatever.
I picked a faith, hope, charity, all clinging together. Right? Those three ideas are together, aren't they? Right. Without us, you'll surely die. Without, I'm going nuts, goodbye. That is blasphemous. Anyway, then beauty. Ah, beauty. As I led her to the window, I told her, you I love best in life, but you're a killer. Beauty kills. Not really meaning to drop her, I immediately ran downstairs, getting there just in time to catch her. You saved me, she cried. I put her down and told her, move on. Went back up those six flights, went to the money. There was no money to throw out. The only thing left in the room was death, hiding beneath the kitchen sink. I'm not real, it cried. I'm just a rumor spread by life. laughing, I threw it out. I threw it out, kitchen sink and all, and suddenly realized humor was all that was left. And what could I do with humor? Out the window with the window?
Nobody writes like Gregory, I swear. You wouldn't even believe it. It just, they come out whole. He'll have the television on and be writing. He'll take a fantastic line from the television and incorporate it into the poem or play on it and do variations.
So one morning I just left and set out. And eventually, after going to Niagara Falls and to, then up to Massachusetts, believe it or not, down through Boston, and eventually Providence, where I stayed. I looked the guy up, stayed about 3 days, couldn't take that scene at all, came down to New York, and I was home. Just like that, I knew it. Just like that. So when I got out of the car that had driven me into New York, it was about 11 o'clock at night. And the guy dropped me at approximately, roughly 103rd and Broadway. He lived up in that section on the west side. And he told me, he said, where are you going? I said, well, I'd like to find 42nd Street. I'd heard about 42nd Street. He said, well, all you have to do, he said, is just stay right on Broadway, just keep walking right straight on down. He said, you'll come to it. So I set out. Boy, everything just delighted me. First, I had gave me some money, and the first thing I did was buy a carnation for my buttonhole. They were selling them on the street, and I liked flowers. I felt real cocky coming down the street with a cigar box. I had always traveled with a cigar box, a pair of socks, a razor, and blah, 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 little odds and ends. But it was handy and, you know, small, not too heavy. And when you travel by your thumb, you can almost always keep yourself somewhat neat appearing. But I wasn't disappointed in the least. I liked the lights, I liked the feeling of excitement, I liked the way the people moved. There was just something here that was fresh. Well, I was participating in everything that I could do. I was hustling. You want it in so many words, is that right? What do you doing?
No. come on a trip with me to a land full of love and ecstasy, where the moon shines bright, the sun has a light that'll put you in the mood to make love all night. The people here party hard all year, there's no kind of hate in the atmosphere. Check us out on the party nights, the city is packed, the time is right. You meet all kinds of people for miles around, cause they only come out when the best in town. So if you wanna have fun, this is the place to be, where the disco goes continuously.
People seemed a lot freer here in their actions than they did elsewhere, and that was after having traveled a little bit.
I always assumed that he and Gregory had known each other a long time, but they didn't really know each other. And as they got to know each other, Gregory wound up with a terrific kind of respect for Herbert, you know, as this old guy who knows.
There was a guy who went through his garbage every day, looking for a bag of dope, empty bag.
The police. From
not the police, him, so he could write about it and sell it to the newspapers.
In those days, I used to steal. I was a thief. Not a very good one, I must admit, but later I became a good burglar, I'll say that.
I was in the big prison that he ended up in before he went there, though he is older than me. Yes, let me tell you that one. That's a big
one. You went to prison
before him? Of course. Okay. He ended up, Mr. Herbert Huncke, in Dannemora prison. He entered when I left, and that's a fact of life. I entered Dannemora prison, Clinton prison, at the Canadian border, in 1947, at the beginning of 47. I had to do 2 to 3 years. I entered the youngest, they told me, ever in that prison, and I left the youngest ever in that prison. I left at 19. When I got to talk to Herbert about his prison days, he had mentioned that he had ended up, after Sing Sing and all that, in Dannemora. And I said, oh, really? What year? Do you have any idea what year? Did you ever ask him that? Well, why the fuck didn't you ask him that? These are important things about people's lives. Yeah. Like, I got a one-upmanship on that 76-year-old bastard, and I'm 62. That's a one-upmanship.
79.
He went in 79?
No, he is 79.
He's 79. Even more so. Even more, he's 79-year-old fart, and here I am, a 62-year-old angel, and, anyway, being in Dannemora prison, the heaviest prison in New York State, okay?
It was all, it was the tombs, whether it's today or then, it's the tombs, you're buried in there. It's a matter of adjustment, a matter of adjustment. Sometimes a guy gets in, and I've seen them just fall right up. They're terrified completely. But, you know, they sit in a corner and they're afraid of everything. If you're gonna go, when you go in, no matter where you go or what you do, always remember, it behooves you to, you know, get involved in it in some way. Don't always be a victim.
It also introduced Kerouac, Ginsberg, and Burroughs to Times Square. That was a world of petty criminals, of hustlers, sex hustlers, pimps, and serious dope, as well as Kinsey, the great sex researcher. Herbert turned Burroughs on for the first time, an amazing feat. That alone will get you into the history books. But he introduced them to a whole underground phenomenon, a reality that none of them probably could have penetrated on their own.
I would never have known them unless I had a criminal record, in all probability.
I see.
I think they came looking for excitement vicariously. Why would they have been interested in, you know, 42nd Street and what they thought was the underworld at that time? I represented the underworld to them. They thought they'd gotten real close to the real thing, let's put it that way. So that's how it affected them.
Smoke it up. Cocaine and acid. Lotto, what's up? How many hits? Got rock cocaine. Come down and see us. Got it good.
I used to hang around there in 1942 and 43 when the war was on. I was a 12-year-old, 13-year-old and ran away from home. And I would get money and food from these old faggots who would come by and pick me up to take me out to eat, and I'd run. I never had sex with the son of a bitches, but I'd eat first. I knew that game. In fact, that's where I was busted to go to Dannemora. I was living on 42nd Street, and that hotel is still there, 42nd and 9th Avenue. Okay? We had the walkie-talkie gang, and they popped us. I never encountered him in those days when I hung around that area, which is the most deplorable area to hang around. I mean, only the lowest of the low hang around there. You got nothing to offer society or even themselves. Hang around there to burn people, to steal from them, to hustle them, and all that kind of shit. And that's where Herbert hung around. There was nothing classy there. If he would have hung around Greenwich Village, he might have had the ball game.
It wasn't my place. I didn't want to see the village, and I told you why. I was kind of fed up with the so-called bohemian scene.
Gregory Corso said about Herbert, he was born with the right name, and he had the perfect face for his life. But what did Herbert bring to the Beats? Let's look at the original four Beats. Three of them had an Ivy League background. Kerouac was still writing in a traditional romantic post-Thomas Wolfe style and was working on a kind of Bildungsroman of a traditional structure, generational family kind of problems, that sort of thing. Allen Ginsberg was experimenting eclectically with various poetry styles and was heavily influenced by William Blake and hadn't yet found his real voice. William Burroughs hadn't written much of anything at the time. And Gregory Corso was a young kid, the youngest of the Beats, fresh out of jail and already writing poetry. Probably the least influenceable of the bunch.
I think I started them all moving, frankly. They certainly were a deadbeat bunch other than verbalization when I first met them. All of them.
Also, it should be said, Herbert is a character in the earliest Beat novels that exist, even in The Town and the City. In fact, you can see his influence on Kerouac. The novel begins like a traditional kind of novel of the generations. The kids are going to rebel against the parents, all that sort of thing. And Kerouac finally meets Huncke. He meets Ginsberg and these people, but he meets Huncke on Times Square, and Huncke already starts dragging them about and stuff. And from that point on, the language is a little bit freer, and you can see that Kerouac's already outgrown the form of The Town and the City, and his next book is going to be a radical departure, because in that interim, he finally meets Neil Cassidy, and everything happens.
In fact, it was a total surprise that Kerouac became a writer to both Joan and myself. He was always very reluctant to reveal himself. Primarily, I think, because he didn't want to. He had some idea that he must not hurt his mother. She was the governing factor in his life. Everything was for her benefit, not his own, for her, to shine in her eyes, to justify the pain of having born him and raised him and, you know, fed him and clothed him to a certain age, and he must pay that back in some way. So his life was dedicated to that, and he found that it was possible to express himself by words. And he had a marvelous vocabulary, a really wonderful vocabulary, and knew how to use it. Just read any of his stuff, it just flows out. And musically, as well as, you know, dramatically, any expression that he wants to put into it is there. And he knew how to write in his own way. Of course, it was new to the majority, but just on the strength of that alone, he gained a great deal of reputation. And he certainly chose a subject that was exciting to the majority of young people who were trying to break away from everything at that time. There was a whole attitude, the angry young men.
Gregory's been incredibly ignored, considering his stature. I mean, there's not even anyone close to him, I don't think. Not anywhere near him. I mean, he is a great poet.
Puma, this is Mexico still, Puma in Chapultepec Zoo. Long, smooth, slow, soft, swift cat. What score? Whose choreography did you dance when they pulled the final curtain down? Can such ponderous grace remain here all alone on this 9x10 stage? Will they give you another chance, perhaps, to dance the Sierras? How sad you seem. Looking at you, I think of Ulanovic, locked in some small furnished room in New York City on East 17th Street in the Puerto Rican section.
I think Herbert is even underestimated as a writer by a lot of people who don't know. When you look at his writing, it's a string of simple declarative sentences. There's absolutely no metaphors. Homer only used one metaphor, interestingly enough. And Herbert returns to a kind of basic telling what he sees in front of his eyes, not pretending to know what, not guessing at stuff, not speculating, but simply describing like a camera what's in front of him. And I think his stories have had a tremendous impact on that whole new journalism, all that sort of thing, you know. So he really truly is a seminal influence on a lot of people, not just the Beats.
Times, doing as we desire, some things together, or on other times going off on our own, never knowing when we would meet again. Regardless, the inconsistency, liking strange attachments, which always brought us back together, seemingly destined to last to whatever end. As a matter of fact, seldom bothered with the thought. That's it.
That's it.